So we have people with microphones wandering the audience, and until you get to someone, I'm just going to ask a question. Given that you've shown the importance of recognizing depression and other mental health issues in caregivers, what can healthcare providers do to identify these problems in the caregiver and help the identified patient? Are there some examples of questions you can ask that are sensitive and respectful, and resources that you can suggest for the caregiver once you're aware they have their own issues?
Okay, well, thank you. Technologically and vertically challenged, So Allison asked about, you know, how do we, first of all, how do we find out whether or not the caregiver is depressed? I think that was the first part. And I think a good tool to use is the PHQ-9. You can use the PHQ-2 as a screening tool because it asks two questions, very simple. One is on mood and one is on engagement in activities. And if the person screens positive on that, then you would go to the full questionnaire, the PHQ-9. It's available as a free download on that website. It is translated into multiple languages. It is easy to score and interpret, and it's widely used right now, as well as the CESD that was mentioned earlier. But in primary care settings in particular, the PHQ-9 is popular. So once you've determined that the person has a level of depression, and you think that they would benefit from one of these forms of psychotherapy that we've been talking about, you can refer to a specialist if you don't have that particular level of training. Or you can suggest other alternatives that might be more available to the individual depending on their background, their resources, and so forth.
This question is for Dolores. Dolores, I have a veteran, and it's my understanding that you work with the VA. I'm here. I'm behind the podium.
Okay. Oh, I see.
So I have a veteran, and it's my understanding you work with the VA. Is that correct?
Yes. Uh-huh.
And so the veteran has had the primary caregiver for 2.5 years. At what point is the VA able to intervene and recommend CBT for that caregiver? When there's obvious signs of need.
I don't think that the, correct me if I'm wrong, those of you who are in the VA system now, but I don't think that the VA provides cognitive behavior therapy to caregivers. I think they do provide, however, a variation of the original REACH program. It's REACH for the VA, which is a psychoeducational evidence-based program, and I believe that's the primary program that's available in the VA now. Is that correct?
So there is a caregiver outreach service, but a lot of it is directed at younger veterans. Someone back there wanted to say something?
Yeah, actually, the home-based primary care program.
I have a microphone.
Oh, God.
Yeah.
Yeah, we actually can provide CBT in home-based primary care for caregivers to manage their stress.
Okay.
And where is he living? So is he San Jose? Home-based primary care comes to your house? Then come see me afterwards.
Great. Okay, and we have another person over here.
I read a study where the family pool of caregivers is reducing, the numbers of people in a family that can actually be supportive. And it's talked about the economic conditions of caregivers and having the family member in the home and whether they're supported financially or not. And in other countries, that seems to be the case in some countries. And I'm wondering what you know about the situation here in this country about financially supporting caregivers so that part of the stress and the anxiety is lessened. Mm-hmm. You know, because going into a care facility is thousands and thousands of dollars a month, so, or hiring the paid caregivers.
Anybody?
Just
Just one thought is that it's another argument for the technological approaches, because we have to think about the cost of these interventions and the enormous financial burden of caregiving. Even people who start off in pretty good financial shape may find themselves less and less able to keep up. So one of these ideas of the technology is to make them kind of narrow and skinny and affordable. We've been working with a tech company in Redwood City to develop some in-home assistive technology, and most of the discussions are about cost, you know, and how can you keep this to an affordable thing. And I know one of the things they've been talking about is to offer some of these technologies through other service providers, like power companies that, you know, normally are dealing with you, and they can sort of amortize the costs over longer periods of time. So I there's a lot of really concerned people, I think, who are thinking about these financial issues.
Yeah, just for my mom, we looked at memory care. It's $10,000 a month, and that's not reimbursed by Medicare. So it's just mind-blowing. We considered that as a topic for our update, so recommended on your forms. The costs of one of our board members suggested that as a topic. Other questions? With the microphone.
Hello, I have a question for Dolores, perhaps a little bit of a Chinese angle. It's usually a cultural imperative for Chinese to take care of your parents. I mean, it's, you know, you have to. It's an obligation. And I've taken Alzheimer's Association excellent Savvy Caregiver course given by Rachel May recently. Also attended a retreat at Saratoga, Hakone Garden, and it's all Chinese. But one thing that came out is that, you know, while you have this cultural imperative, it's kind of set you up for burnout. So my question to you is, how do you self-aware? What's the best way to be able to recognize you're burning out?
Mm-hmm. Well, I think that what we found in working with the Chinese community was exactly what you said. The filial piety expectations are very strong, and it's very difficult for caregivers to acknowledge that they are having stress, that they are distressed, because it's expected that you will provide this care without complaining. But what we were able to intervene with was communication amongst the family members, because often there was conflict among family members as to how to treat mom or dad, you know, what who pays for what. So working on communication and problem solving became an important part of the intervention. Also, I think that we found that using a DVD approach rather than using the face-to-face kind of therapy that we're used to, but putting some of these ideas onto a DVD with an accompanying workbook was actually very appealing to many Chinese caregivers. We provided these free of charge for quite some time, and we got good feedback because there was no, it was something that was self-paced. People could work on their own time, they could work in their own setting, and they could share the information with other family members. So I think it's important to recognize that even though the demands are there, it's very natural and reasonable that the caregiver will become stressed and depressed and anxious and frustrated and feel burned out and worn out over time, irregardless of their cultural background. I think it just goes with the territory. But I think we have to find culturally syntonic ways of presenting information so that the caregiver can get some help and be a better caregiver and stay in the role longer and not have care recipients who die early. So I think it's a matter of figuring out how to deliver the information and how to engage the person in their own self-care.
We have somebody on your right.
One quick thing to that, because be interested in whether you think this makes sense. One of my graduate students just did a study where she contacted a fairly large group of Chinese-American caregivers and of patients with dementia. And she used the scale. So we're always interested in who gets depressed and who doesn't. And this is an all-Chinese sample. And there's a scale in the research literature called the FACE scale. And it has to do with how the importance of maintaining a good front and being respected by others. And what she found is that the higher the caregiver, the more important FACE was for the Chinese caregiver, the more depression they developed in response to patients who had behavioral symptoms like acting out and agitation. So it may be that there's a subgroup of Chinese and Chinese American caregivers who might be particularly at risk. I don't know if that makes sense to you, but it was a pretty powerful finding. And we haven't published it yet, but it's. As you may know, when you have graduate students, you have to push gently and use both the carrot and the stick. I would expect that sometime in the next year we'll get that out.
Okay, someone in the back?
Yes, I'd like to make a comment and ask for your comments about something that's a complication about looking at the mental health of caregivers. At the VA, we often find that the caregiving situation starts when a patient is diagnosed with MCI. And but the further complication is that both the caregiver and the person who's being diagnosed have MCI. Usually the caregiver is not diagnosed. They're just younger and somewhat more mild. And we find that the families of these individuals only focus on the person with the more severe MCI and expect the caregiver that it's their responsibility to be the primary caregiver. So I would like to know something about the comments that you might have about extending and changing the family's perception as to who might need the support for cognitive impairments. The second thing I want to comment on is at the VA, we do offer a form of cognitive remediation embedded in psychotherapy. And what's important, the comment I want to make is looking at the dropout rate. The dropout rate for caregivers is huge at a certain point, and when we ask them why they're dropping out, they say something to the effect of, I know this works, but I absolutely have no more time left in my day to learn one more thing, even when offered respite in the hospital. And so I'd like some comments about the situation of the caregiver who's beginning to experience MCI and has reached a point in their journey about the symptoms of the person with dementia that they're treating where we're already at the end stage of their capacity to make changes.
Okay. Well, I think that what I would probably do in that situation is call a family meeting, if I could, you know, to try to get the other family members engaged so that they understood that the person that they're designating as the primary caregiver may not really be able to do that job very well. Now, we don't know if the MCI is going to progress to dementia in either of the two parties. So, but a preliminary discussion with interested family members, like in a family meeting, I think could be helpful to clarify roles and to get the idea across from the beginning that this is a shared responsibility. It isn't just the job of one primary caregiver, but it needs to be shared among family members, friends, and the network that the person is part of. So that would be one suggestion.
And I just want to confirm that from a scientist's point of view, you know, when we talk to caregivers who came to our laboratory, and it's about 600 we've talked to over the past 15 years. They were saying, you know, we're the ignored part of the problem. We are suffering. We have needs. We want to do a good job. And they were delighted that anyone was interested in doing serious research on preventing decline in the caregiver. So I think this is part of a realignment, and just understand that both as therapists and scientists, this is a very important problem, and it's one where we could get some great traction.
Okay, with that, I want to conclude this session. Just to say one more thing, listening to Howie's talk, we've come a long way. So many things we thought were impossible over these 20 years have become possible. So don't ever lose hope.